Good afternoon. Welcome. You have entered into the recovery room. Thank you for joining me tonight. Wherever you are in the world, welcome back. Whether this be your first time or second time, I welcome you back again. And also, let me mention that prophetic art that you just saw. I hope that encouraged all the prophetic artists out there to walk in your calling, to be bold, and to step out. So tonight's conversation, the title is the essence of sound. Sound is also your voice, and this is going to be part one. Part two will air next week, but we're going to be setting the foundation tonight. So let's pray before we get started. Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, we honor you, we worship you, we adore you, we bless your wonderful and holy name. Father, we repent of every sin, whatever we said, did, or thought that was not pleasing in your holy sight. We ask you to forgive us, Father. Your words say that you're faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In the mighty name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, I ask you to work through me, work in me. I cannot do this without you. I need your help. And I pray in the name of Jesus, Father, I ask you to release divine insight, divine wisdom and knowledge into the hearts and minds of the listeners who will be listening tonight and in the future or whenever they view this video. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so let's move on to the scriptures. We're gonna turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7. And it reads as follow: a time to tear, a time to mend, a time to be silent, a time to speak. This is the time to unlock and lift your voice with boldness. First on the menu, let's talk about the meaning of the word essence. According to the Merriam-Webster dictionary, essence is defined as the most significant element, quality, or aspect of a thing or a person. It's one that possesses or exhibits quality and abundance as if in concentrated form, meaning that the word essence means your uniqueness, your qualities that only you possess. So let's move on to this clip. So tonight, as I mentioned, our title is The Essence of Your Sound. So we're coming out of Ecclesiastes. And again, it's your time to lift up your sound, which is also your voice, which I will be, instead of saying voice, I will be using the word sound. So let's look at some synonyms to the word sounds to make it a little easy to understand. No, I'm sorry, not the word sound, but the word essence. So a synonym is words that are phrases that mean exactly or nearly the same as another word in the same language. So as you can see here, there are several synonyms that means the same as essence. For example, nature, heart and soul, the core, the center, substance, spirit, life, blood, heart, principle, soul, and your core. John 16 and 13 declares, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. So let's move on to the next clip. Guess what? God knows your sound. God knows you, therefore he knows your sign. No matter how old you are, no matter where you are in your life, no matter what your background is, he knows your sound. So let's look at Psalms 139, 1 through 18. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit, when I rise. You perceive my thoughts. from afar. You discern my going out, my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, my Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Matthew 10 and 30 tells us, even the very hairs on your heads are numbered. We don't even know this, but God knows this about each and every one of us. God knows all of our movements. He knows when we sit down, when we rise up. He knows when we go somewhere. He knows when we come home. He knows when we rest. He even knows our thoughts and our intentions before they even manifest. God knows the ways. God knows our ways, the kind of life that we choose to live in. He also knows our words before we say them. And he also knows what we need before we need it. And God has seen and known us from the beginning as well as the end. Therefore, since God knows us through and through, he definitely knows our sound. I believe that God even knows each person's sounds, even through their tears. That's just how well he knows us. When close family know your sound without seeing you, that's just like God knowing your sound. Let me give you an example. I'm a mother. I have three daughters. Whenever, whenever we go to the mall or go to the store and they are looking for me, and this happened when they were younger, when they were little, they would hear my voice. And they didn't see me, but they knew it was mama because of the sound of my voice. They knew me. And it's the same thing with them. When I hear them, without seeing them, I know their voice. And I believe that when a mother hears the sound of the child, even when they are giving birth, I believe that sound stays with them for the rest of their lives. That's their eternal sound. And even the unborn baby knows your sound. When you're caring for your baby, after your baby is born, and even in the womb, your baby knows your sound because they move. They can hear your voice and they move, meaning they know your sound. So why do people hate to hear their sound? Why do they hate to hear their voice? And I can relate to this because at one point in my life, I felt this way. So let's talk about this. When we hear our sound from a recorder, and I say a recorder because that's the way that we can go back and hear our sound after our voice is recorded. We only hear the external sounds that pass through the air. This is also how other people hear our sound. We don't hear the internal voice that passes through the bones and the flesh. Which is why we hate the sound of our own voice when we hear it on a recording. So there's the difference between your self-perception and your reality, because your voice is unique and is an important component of your self-identity. So this mismatch can clash. Suddenly you realize other people have heard something else all along. When you hear your voice, you're hearing something different, and others are hearing something different. Some become so unsettled about hearing their voice, they refuse to listen to a recorded voice message. The discomfort that we have about hearing our sound is probably due to a mix of physiology and psychology. Physiology is the study of how living things work and function. Psychology is the scientific study of the mind and the behavior. So even though we may actually sound more like our recorded voice to others, we may think that the reason so many of us squirm when we hear our sound is not that the recording voice is necessarily worse than the perceived sound. Instead, we simply are more used to hearing ourselves sound a certain way. So when we hear our voice on a recorder, it sounds different from when you hear yourself through your inner ear. Not liking the sound of your voice is common. It's not an individual or a isolated thing. It's common. So there's a term for that. It's called voice confrontation. In psychology, voice confrontation is related to self-confrontation. This phenomenon of a person not liking their own voice, that's the definition of voice confrontation. The phenomenon is generally caused by disappointment due to differences between what a person expects their voice to sound like to other people and what they actually hear in the recording. So how can we use our voice? How can we use our sound? We can use our sound in many ways. One way we can use our sound is to advocate for others. Proverbs 31, 8 through 9 tells us, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. For the rights of all who are destitute, speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. The righteous care about the justice for the poor, but the wicked have no such concern. So there are stories of advocacy throughout the Bible. Think of Moses and Daniel. Say like for Moses, for an example, to secure the Israelites' freedom, Moses uses his connection to Pharaoh to speak for the people. Daniel speaks up on behalf of himself and his friends and his faith when he and his friends are taken from their own people and delivered to King Nebuchadnezzar. One determined sound can help change lives around the world. Could this voice be your sound? 1 John 2:1 tells us that Jesus is our advocate. He speaks up on our behalf. We are called to speak up and be a sound for the voiceless. God has called us to plead for those who can't plead or fight for themselves. He calls us to stand up for others. What are you doing to speak up for what you know is right? Who are you advocating for? Who are you speaking up for? When our voices are amplified, we serve those who go unheard, and that honors God. Secondly, there's also authority in your sound. We have all been given a voice by God. One of the joys of the enemy is to silence our sound and make sure the authority of God's sound is lost. The enemy will steal our sound without warning or notice. It's important that we are grounded in the word and also know how to take back what is rightfully ours. The best part about yanking your sound back from the enemy is that you are glorifying God all at the same time. God loves when we use our voice and his word to overcome the devil. Romans 8:14 tells us, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. When you are led by the Spirit, God will fill your mouth with the words he wants you to speak. God has called upon us to be his voice on the earth, to be his sound on the earth. He expects us to share the gospel and share the good news. This is why the devil targets our sound, so we can't help in sharing God's word. So never underestimate the authority of your sound. Our sound matters as much as our words matters. They have the power to awaken the senses and lead others to act, to bring empowerment, to bring encouragement, as well as to bring freedom. Simply put, our vocal implant contributes much more than we think to our success, as well as spiritually, personally, and professionally. Like fingerprints, no two sounds have the same characteristics. Every one of us have a unique vocal imprint. Did you know that your voice holds power? I don't know what's been holding you back from speaking up, but I do know that the impact you possess is a God-given gift. So don't waste another precious moment holding your breath and holding your sound. The world needs to hear the message God has put in your sound. The world is waiting. There is authority in your sound when you pray. It's all right to request prayer, but God has given you the authority in your sound to pray for yourself as well as praying for others. Matthew 6:6 tells us, when you pray, go into your closet, close the door, pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Stop expecting others to always pray for you. Let me clarify that statement. It's nothing wrong with asking others to pray for you, to pray with you, or even to come in agreement with you, but they are not supposed to do all the work. You are already equipped to raise your sound in prayer and pray for yourself also. It's biblical to pray for yourself. It's not being selfish. Sometimes people may say, I pray for others, but I feel selfish for praying for myself. Or they may say, I'm already so blessed that I feel guilty asking anyone, asking for anything more from God. So do you know what happens when you don't pray for yourself? When you don't talk to God about yourself, you deprive yourself as well as a strong and personal and intimate relationship with God. The devil wants to mute your sound. And that may not be something new. Maybe you have heard that before, but let's talk about that a little bit. He wants to sound mute your sound both naturally and spiritually. The enemy plan is to mute, muzzle, and mask your ability to speak out of your mouth. Your mouth is a weapon against the enemy. God says to not be silent, censored, muted, and mass, but to speak up and speak out of your mouth. The enemy doesn't want you to speak clearly and boldly out of your mouth. He wants the words spoken out of your mouth to sound muzzled, confusing, and distorted. Don't allow the enemy to muzzle, mute, and mass your mouth to speak in this season. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 8 through 10 says, did I say this from a human perspective? Doesn't the law say the same thing? For it is written in the law of Moses, do not muzzle an ox while it is treading out the grain. If the ox is muzzled, then they are unable to eat the corn that keeps them working. The enemy wants to muzzle your mouth so that you starve spiritually and keep you from being fed by the word of God and releasing the truth through your sound. So what is the devil's three-step plan to silence your voice? He has a plan, just like he has a plan for everything else. Number one, overwhelm the culture with sin. As we've seen, Paul prophesied that in the last days that they will be difficult. He concluded his words with a serious warning. They will be overwhelmed by their sins and swayed by all kinds of desires, according to 2 Timothy 3:6. Overwhelmed by sin in the world. To be overwhelmed means to be so bombarded by something until it defeats you. This is exactly how Satan uses sin today in order to destroy us. From the moment we are born, Satan tries to set us up for failure. He does this by inundating our world with so much filth and perversion. Satan's goal is to see us fall into the trap so we can lose our focus and get us to use our sound for the wrong things, to say the wrong words. Number two, he sways with desires. This is critical to his strategy because he knows that where the mind goes, the man follows. Before long, we're consumed with the pleasures of the flesh until we can't get away from what we're from what we know is wrong. This is why Paul meant by a people swayed by all kinds of desires. Satan intends that we become so addicted to sin that we lead like animals on a leash from one regretful experience to the next. Another tactic that he uses to silence our sound is to get us to keep feeling like that we have to get our life right before we can use our sound. But we can't do it on our own. We can't save ourselves. We need God. And number three, taunt with accusations. By definition, a setup is a scheme or a trick intended to incriminate someone. And that's the end result of Satan's setup. He overwhelms a lot of guilt and shame. The devil says, look what you've done. And you think God is going to use you to speak for him? Or he may say, you are in too deep and it's too late for you. Satan's accusations are intended to silence your sound. He'll tell you that you messed up so bad and that you're too far gone. It's all a strong plan because Satan knows that the greatest hindrance to being used by God is to believe that you can't be used by God. What could be more destructive to people whose greatest fears are living lives that don't make a difference or don't have a purpose? So let's look at how to find and embrace our sound. Number one, recognize your passion. Within each of our hearts, there are passions that brighten our lives and spark excitement. Part of finding your sound is investing in your passion because they help to fuel what you have to share with the world. Nurturing those things that brighten your life can help you towards your sound. Consider what makes you feel alive, what makes you want to get up in the morning, or something that you would never cancel. Choose not to only let these be hobbies, but embrace them every day and in a serious way. And I dare you to accept this challenge. Number two, recognize your strength. What are some of your strengths? Are there places that you find that you naturally excel in, or practicing towards those strengths only adds to the level of the skill that you already have? These strengths can be an avenue towards finding your sound. For many, there is a need to acknowledge strength, because once you do, you can overcome the fear, the intimidation and the insecurity of stepping out into your strength. If you were given a talent, it's a gift and it's something you should not waste. So don't waste the talent that God has given you. Invest in it, grow it, nurture it. You'll never know how God might just use that talent He'll give you that He gave you with your name on it. Number three, pray and clarify. Pray for clarity and discernment. The most valuable step of all is discovering and embracing your sound, is partnering with God. Using your sound should glorify Him who graciously gave you that sound, but there must be a connection to understand how, when, and what context to use it. Come before God in prayer to ask for clarity and discernment of what it looks like to come into the person that He has created you to be. Remember that it is not an overnight thing. Growth takes time. Perhaps God has taken time to prepare you and your sound for something big. Don't discount your season. Position yourself now, because every moment in preparation matters towards the big picture. Number four, boldness to step up into your sound. In accepting your sound, your true self, and who you were made to be, there will be a call towards becoming bold. This may look like sharing in front of crowds, or this could be something that looked like a courageous leap from something you never thought you have the courage to do. In any situation, boldness becomes the next step into standing firm and standing tall and using your sound. Remember that even in the face of fear that can overwhelm you, or the passing thoughts that come to discourage you from the enemy, God has called you forward into this daring place for a reason. Partner with God. Again, partner with God. Confirm everything with him. Then boldly step into all that he has called you to do at this moment and in this season. You never know how it could impact your life and other people's lives. Number five, challenge yourself. Life is full of challenges, whether they come from outside places or if they come from the inner place called to give yourself a challenge or a goal. At times, that inner desire to rise up is needed to get yourself to the next level. Without a doubt, it will feel uncomfortable at first, but think about how that very moment could be the one that years from now you mark as a moment that everything changed for you, that everything changed in your life spiritually, professionally, and in all areas. The minute in time that you choose to embark on something bigger than what you had known or ever seen before, and the time in which you truly embrace and carry out the sound that's locked up on the inside of you, waiting to be released. You will never know unless you take the leap into trying. Whether you're stepping out and you're trying in fear, you're trembling, you're nervous, you're experiencing anxiety, move through it and try. Align yourself with God and see where he might lead you to challenge yourself to this new season in your life. Remember, your words have power. The Bible says in Proverbs 18 and 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. When your words go out into the atmosphere of the world, it is the same as when God said, "Let there be light," in the book of Genesis. The enemy wants to keep the sound, kill your sound. He wants to kill your sound because the sound of victory tears down the walls of lies of the enemy. The enemy knows if you ever get the courage to speak up and confront your giant, you will find your crown on the other side. Don't be embarrassed and don't be ashamed. Put the enemy on blast. Let people see your scars. Don't be ashamed. Let them see your wounds and declare to the world, "Yes, I might have gone through some ugly trials, but I'm still here. I might have gone through the wilderness, but I'm still here. I may have gotten hurt and betrayed, but I'm still here. I may have had some disadvantages, but I'm still here. I may have experienced some trauma. I may have experienced some abuse, some mistrust and deception, but guess what? I'm still here." The enemy is scared of someone who is willing to step out. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You need to remind yourself of what the Word of God says about you and what God has brought you through in faith. Declare it over your life and over anybody else's life that you come in contact with, over your family, over your children, over your grandchildren, over your spouse. Fire is contagious, and the enemy is trying to put your fire out and by drowning out your sound. Imagine with your sound, you can set a fire to the enemy's camp. You can burn down the walls of lies and insecurity. You can burn down the walls of sin and shame. You can burn down the walls of fear and doubt. Just because you choose to speak life and truth and let your sound ring. Do not let the silence, the enemy silence you and take your sound. The enemy knows if you speak life, your mind will be transformed. Your life will be transformed. Your sound will encourage other souls as well as your own. Your sound will bring the walls of delays down. I challenge you today to open your mouth and let your sound be released. I challenge you to be loud with your sound of victory, and boldly allow your testimony to be spoken through your sound. I pray that this message helps someone tonight. I pray that this message answers some questions pertaining to this topic. And I pray that you were blessed by the information. So, Father, we honor you, we worship you, we adore you. Father, I thank you for using me to release what you have given me in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, I just ask you to encourage your people. And I pray that this message brought some level of encouragement in the mighty name of Jesus. And I pray that somebody who's listening will take these words, they will take them to heart, and then they will digest it. And they will step out on faith, no matter how much fear, no matter what happened in their lives, that they will not allow it to hold them back any longer by using their sound in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you, we honor you, we worship you, we adore you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. I look forward to seeing you next week. Take care.
Lift every voice and sing, sing earth, heaven, ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies resound. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun. March on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn has died, yet with a steady beat and not our tears have been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughter. Out from the gloomy past till now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our star is cast. Oh, This is our God where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk of the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand.